Torrey Snow.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL Radio app.
All right, well, it is Friday, and it's kind of a cool way. I'm considering this a bit of a birthday present for me. It is my birthday today, and so feel free to wish me a happy birthday. I'm 41 years old, but no, I've actually been extremely excited to talk about the Piedmont Reliability Project, and for several reasons. I'm a nerd for this kind of stuff. I've always been interested in energy generation and how we move it around and advances in technologies and all of the steps that we take to try to make sure that our society is powered. And I've been hearing about the Piedmont Reliability Project. By the way, this is not a new thing. So this has been rumbling for about, actually a little over a month is when I first began to hear a little bit about it. But I've been kind of keeping an eye on it. And the resistance to this project has picked up steam. Doing more research into it and understanding the implications of the Piedmont Reliability Project has been fascinating to me. A 70-mile-long transmission line that will be run across Western Maryland. And what's been most interesting is that you're seeing different, you know, perspectives come out. Joining us now to discuss one of those perspectives is Joanne Frederick, who is the president of Stop MPRP Incorporated. And Ms. Frederick, thank you so much for joining the program. And look, as we really kind of get into why there's so much criticism and resistance to this project, can you basically summarize why this organization was started and what exactly are your major concerns about this project?
Absolutely, Torrey, and thank you for having me, and let me wish you a happy birthday. I feel honored to be here with you on your birthday. So thank you.
Well, thank you for accepting our invitation on very, very short notice, like literally 20 minutes before the show.
Exactly. It's okay. We're learning to tap dance here in the new organization. So, essentially on July 8th, many folks here in, I'm in Baltimore County, and many folks in Baltimore, Carroll, and Frederick County learned that starting on the 9th of July, the very next day, there would be a series of public information sessions held by PSEG, and the folks would come in and give us information about this new proposed power line that was going to cut across Baltimore, Carroll, and Frederick County. And I don't mean to correct you. We don't really consider this Western Maryland, kind of due north of Baltimore, but yeah, Central Maryland, let's say, down north of Baltimore and then all the way across to Frederick. So obviously some upset, and if you look at the proposed line, you can go onto the map that PSEG provided, and it's shocking and distressing and catastrophic and upsetting for many, many folks that you could put your address in and all of a sudden a giant yellow power line was going to take your property. So that was, one, it felt a bit like a surprise attack, as if we were, invaded by a foreign land or nation that had come in and all of a sudden was going to run tanks through our property, 70 miles long and 500 feet wide. So lots of folks showed up, and credit to all of the people across the three counties and more who showed up at the very last minute to these information sessions, which were, I think, for most of us, frustrating and didn't really give us answers. For those who had gone, PSEG set up a series of tables and you could go around and ask questions, but there really wasn't a presentation about what this was about, and it seemed more like a divide and conquer strategy.
So that
was the beginning of this journey.
Yeah, and actually, yeah. I want to go back to something you said. So you said that you got notification a day before the hearings. Aren't there requirements for like 2 weeks in advance or 4 weeks? I don't know. Maybe there's different requirements for this, but at most public hearings, I've always been known that there's like a minimum posting requirement. Is that not the case for something like this?
So this was not a hearing. We're not to that point in the process yet. And I know you'll have Mr. Cowell on later, and I'm sure he'll, share information about the timeline. So these public information sessions were really PSEG's first scheduled sessions to come into the communities and say, hey, guess what? We're coming here to take your land. We're not to the hearing stage yet.
Okay. Which would be like, that's when you get to the PSE phase, right? And they're looking
correct.
At this. Okay.
Correct.
I got you.
Exactly.
So given the PJM has identified specifically the Piedmont region is requiring some level of reinforcement, is the concern primarily around the specific route that they're taking or that they're trying to do this initiative at all?
So every day we learn more and we're getting smarter and smarter, and we have hundreds of volunteers in the organization now. I'm happy to talk about that again in a bit. So the bottom line is this. We are not creating enough power to meet the energy needs in Maryland today. Mm-hmm. We are increasing the demand on the power grid through things like data centers, AI, et cetera. And in this Mid-Atlantic region, there are states that create more energy than they use and states that create less energy than they use. And it is the job of the regional transmission organizations to pass that energy around from one state to another. Mm-hmm. So the challenge becomes the siloed and, I'll say, piecemeal nature in which we do policy, in which we design programs, in which we do legislation at the federal, state, and local level, that ultimately really is the underlying cause of this. So if you're just solving one piece of the problem and not looking at all the unintended consequences of the other pieces of the problem, then you end up with, we're not making enough power in Maryland, we need to get more, let's import it, or let's just let Maryland be in the middle between Pennsylvania, who's producing a lot of energy, and Virginia, that needs a lot of energy, and Maryland just happens to be in the middle, so let's just put a big extension cord across Maryland in three counties.
So is the proposition, is the stance of the Stop MPRP that Maryland needs to look at new ways to, like, put up more power plants?
I think the position of Stop, well, I know the position of Stop MPRP is this project in its current form is unacceptable. It is not acceptable to come into Maryland to take preserved land, to take agricultural land, to take conserved land, to destroy wetlands, to take private property, to ruin people's homes. Not acceptable. Not acceptable. What's the answer? We're working on that. And it's complicated. Again, back to different states in play here, different state generation, different laws and states, a federal policy that you know, is really relying on decades-old Department of Energy and FERC policy that says, you know, just build power lines and move power around. When really, as technology has increased, as solutions have increased, there is a better way. There are multiple better ways. But what PJM and PSEG are doing is the old, fast, cheap way. Let's just throw a bunch of power lines up and take private land. No one will care. And we're saying that's not okay. That is not okay.
Just reminding our listeners, we're speaking with Joanne Frederick, who's the president of Stop MPRP. And yeah, let's talk a little bit about some of those better ways, because again, a part of this discussion is going to be persuading PJM that there are better ways to approach this. Again, I know that you guys are still kind of in the phase of looking into that, but are there already some kind of proposed alternatives? Because it does seem like there is a need, specifically when it comes to reinforcing the grid. Is there like a work group that's going to hopefully offer forward some better alternatives that PJM or PSEG might consider?
Yes, absolutely. We're working on those things right now. But let me offer one additional kind of nuance here. And so the role of these regional transmission organizations, PJM being one, is, again, the moving around of power. And that was certainly necessary decades ago when we didn't have new technologies, when we didn't have energy storage opportunities coming online, when we didn't have small modular reactors, when we didn't have all of these other mechanisms to create and store power. So when when you're a hammer, you're looking for a nail. Mm-hmm. So I think that the analogy here is the regional transmission organizations certainly did a good job for decades and decades, but now we're in a different era. The demand is growing exponentially across the country. And is it time to request and collaborate and work with our elected officials at all levels of government to say, okay, time for a better way of doing business? And it's not pull out the hammer and drive a nail through three counties in Maryland.
So let me ask you, are you getting support or engagement from the higher levels of government? Have you heard from the state at all? Has Governor Westmore offered any support, or Speaker Jones, or any of the influential members in the General Assembly? What's their stance on this?
So we have talked to several members in the General Assembly. We have not yet heard from Governor Moore. We have requested a meeting with him, and I believe his office is working on finding dates for that. We've invited him to come out and, you know, talk to some of the impacted folks and really understand what the cost is here. And there has been certainly Carroll County delegation, Frederick County delegation, and Delegate Nino Mangione, who is my delegate here in Baltimore County, have come out very strongly and said, no, this is not acceptable. So I think we need to continue, and we are continuing and will continue to do good work with the folks at all different levels of government to really come up with what I would call a multi-layered legislative and policy strategy that has to be implemented, federal, state, and local, in order to make sure that we are meeting the energy needs of the state while not doing so on the backs of the farmers and homeowners and folks that have spent decades and lots of money preserving and conserving their land.
If folks would like to learn more about your organization and what you're doing, how can they get in touch with you or your organization?
Our website at www.stopmprp.com is the best way. They can join, they can donate, they can volunteer, and they can sign up for the email newsletters that we're sending out every day.
Joanne Frederick, the president of Stop MPRP, thank you so much for your time and for joining us on very short notice. And we're eager to hear what Jason Caldwell has to say. Keep us posted on how things progress with you, all right?
And happy to join you again, Torrey, and I hope you have a wonderful birthday.
Take care. That was Joanne Frederick from Stop MPRP. What do you think about this? There were a couple of things specifically about different ways of meeting these energy needs that we'll get into as soon as we get back. Torrey Snow, WBAL.